Hello, good morning. Welcome to the Water Research Foundation webcast, Energy Efficiency in the Water Industry, a global research project. My name is Linda Rieke, and I'm a project manager with the Water Research Foundation. I will be the moderator for today's session. During today's webcast, Roger Middleton will present the results from a global study to identify leading practices in the water and wastewater sectors to improve energy efficiency. Although the study looked at both water and wastewater practices, this webcast will focus on the practices and applications for water utilities to improve energy efficiency and reduce energy use and cost. This research project was sponsored by the United Kingdom Water Industry Research and the Water Research Foundation and several other international water research organizations under the umbrella of the Global Water Research Coalition. The final report is available to Water Research Foundation subscribers on the Foundation website on the page for Project 4270. Before I introduce Roger, let me provide a brief word about the Foundation. We were formed in 1966 and since then have published results of over 900 research projects. In 2009, you're probably aware, we changed our name from the AWWA Research Foundation to the Water Research Foundation. We have a new name, but the same mission and commitment to fund research that provides important data and knowledge to help you provide a safe, reliable drinking water supply to your customers efficiently and effectively. The Foundation's agenda of research topics addresses needs that are immediate and also anticipates future issues. All aspects of water supply and treatment are covered, including source water protection and development, drinking water treatment and distribution, and management of utility operations, including energy management. Over the years, the Foundation has completed at least a dozen research projects to help water utilities reduce energy consumption and cost. In the 1990s, we funded several projects to develop energy and water quality management systems, or EQAMs, for water utilities to optimize water treatment and energy management options. In 1997, we funded a benchmarking project to identify leading practices for energy management. In 2004, we funded a project to identify risks and benefits associated with energy management, and a project to improve water consumption forecasting in order to reduce energy demand of pumping operations. We currently have a project underway that will provide guidance to utilities on pumping station design and operation for energy efficiency. Two reports that will be available this summer include a decision support tool to help water utilities make energy management decisions and a compendium of best practices and case studies focusing on North American water utilities. All of the reports are available to our subscribers. You can either download a PDF or order a published report on our website at www.waterrf.org. As I ready to introduce Roger, I want to remind you that following his presentation, there will be a brief question and answer period. You can ask your questions directly through the webcast webpage by typing your question either during or after the presentation. And if we're unable to get to everyone's questions during today's webcast, we will provide written answers on the Water Research Foundation website next week. The webinar itself will also be available to download next week if you have colleagues who might want to view it. So let me introduce Roger Middleton. Roger was the principal investigator of Energy Efficiency in the Water Industry, a global research project. Roger is a mechanical engineer with a strong interest in sustainability. He has worked in the water and wastewater industry for about 22 years, 20 of those with Black & Veatch. He took a year off in 2003 to read for a master's in engineering for sustainable development at Cambridge University, UK, in collaboration with MIT, and has been increasingly involved in carbon footprinting, renewable energy, and energy efficiency since then. Roger is working with Black & Veatch in the UK to help water utilities with energy efficiency and has just finished an implementation study for the UK Environment Agency to reduce their carbon and energy demands by using hydro, solar PV, and wind renewable energy. Let me turn it over to Roger. Welcome, Roger.
Thank you very much, Linda, and good morning to everyone. Looking at the slide here, we'll run quickly through an agenda. I think the introductions are complete. So what we'll do is review the Aquia and Global Water Research Council Coalition project. And we'll look at the main topics that come out of that project. The first is catchment and resource management. We'll look at pumps in detail, because they are 90% of the problem. We'll look at drinking water process review and see what can come out of that as far as energy efficiency is concerned. We'll also be looking at buildings, and that is those buildings strictly concerned with water treatment, not buildings in general. And we'll also cover renewable energy and the different forms of renewable energy that can help us reduce our net energy demand. We'll end up with a few thoughts as to where we go in the future and how far this project has got us along that line. And then hopefully, as Linda said, we'll turn it over to questions and answers. Okay, so starting off with the first slide on the Aquia project. The project objectives and deliverables were to identify the incremental improvements first, the relatively low-hanging fruit, the bits of energy efficiency optimization that are easy to do with existing assets without changing anything too much. So these are the easy wins. But we didn't aim to stop there, and the Aquia and GWRC were very keen that we also look at the improvements that would demand more of a project approach, a more substantial body of work to realize energy efficiency gains. And they were particularly interested in any novel technology, but restricted us to anything that was proven at full scale. So we were not looking at pilot plant projects yet. So the idea was that the report would present best practice and collate it for all to see, but the main strength would be the examples and case studies of what was being done in the industry all around the world. The organizational issues involved with this project were quite daunting at first, and for an engineer, looking at the number of potential contractual relationships here, it looked a bit of a nightmare, because if you look along the bottom frames there between the US, Europe, Australasia, and Africa, we have a total of 7 clients there, and with the GWRC project steering group and Aquia, we have another 2 clients. But fortunately, everybody was tuned in to the same objectives, and we got along fine, and the project worked, in fact, very well indeed. What Black & Veatch did in all this was really, from the global point of view, we kicked the whole project off with the assistance of the steering group to develop a priority shortlist. This identified where we thought the major energy gains would be. We drafted and agreed a skeleton report, which was basically to see what the final report would look like when it had all its information in there. And we also adopted selection criteria and guidance for going out and obtaining the case studies and examples. And then towards the end of the job, we were to draft a compendium report, get that agreed between the various parties, and also and then conclude a final report, but also to develop proposals for maintenance of the compendium, because it was appreciated that this is very much a live project. Things are moving on here, and the incentive and the topicality of the project meant that it couldn't just be let as an end of a project achievement. Things were going to have to move on from there. On a local basis, Black & Veatch had a more intimate task perhaps with the UK water utilities. And basically, the idea there was that where the continental coordinators were gathering information in their own areas, Black & Veatch were covering the UK in order to present data from and case studies from the UK to the European coordinator. That would then form part of the European report, which would go together with the other continental coordination reports, and then we would collate the outcome of those 4 reports. What in fact happened was the UK report was substantially bigger than the European report, So we put together the whole thing at the end from those inputs. To look at the case study guidelines, what we wanted from the continental coordinators was hopefully a fairly uniform approach to the information that was coming back to us, so that it would be an easy job to collate it. Obviously here the ideal would be scientific information based on one step at a time changes, and obviously auditable outputs. But the reality was that in any water industry, any utility, we very rarely get that. So we have to be a lot more pragmatic. And obviously, when we usually get a chance to change things in the water industry, we get any downtime, we take advantage of it, we change as much as we possibly can to get as near to optimum as we possibly can. So that was our pragmatic approach there. So examples of case studies really came up to be anything from simple three-liners, which usually came from the operations people direct. So we thought we had a problem here. This was our energy usage. These were the changes we made, and this is what we ended up with, and this was the energy saving we made. And even if that was only verbal, we were quite prepared to take those examples at that end of the scale. But however, if on a larger plant there was perhaps a PhD in progress, then we were very keen to take that end of the information as well. Now, the last item on this slide says that the boxes in the water cycle matrix were not meant to be restrictive. We were looking for all sorts of information here, and anywhere across the spectrum was really fair game. We didn't want to rule out any potential information or potential gains for the project at this stage. So I'll explain about the matrix in the next slide. And here is what we came up with and what evolved from the first steering group meeting. And you will see across the top there that we have the water cycle energy saving matrix divided into clean water or drinking water and wastewater. So in the row below that you have raw water, treatment and distribution. And then the project actually excluded what happened with the consumer, largely, not completely. But then we picked up again in detail with sewerage, wastewater treatment and disposal. So there you have the entire water matrix, the entire spectrum there from abstraction to disposal. And then down the left-hand side there, the second column in from the left, you will see all the processes that we use in the industry to achieve that, that spectrum and to treat water and wastewater all the way through the processes. And then in the middle, obviously, we have the case studies under various codes according to where they've come from. Now, the electronics and the wizardry here actually allows us in the project document itself, in the electronic document, very quick access to whatever information is in there, because we were very concerned that this project would turn out a lot of information, and the danger was that it would be parked in a big file to sit on the back of someone's desk gathering dust. So what we were very keen on here was to have this information accessible. So those processes down the left-hand side of the matrix here, on the electronic document, if you click on any of those processes, that takes you straight through a link into what we've called a fact sheet. And that explains all about that process, the technical and managerial implications, what you can do about energy efficiency in those processes, and it references case studies to do with those processes. So you can get very quickly into the processes that you're interested in. Even better, having looked at the matrix and decided which squares of that matrix you were in, you can then click on any of those case studies that are coded there, and the links take you straight into the case studies. And again, everything is cross-referenced. So you can look at that matrix and very quickly realize where your interests lie at any particular time, and you can get into the information very quickly indeed. The table on the top right there shows you where the case studies came from. No real comments any further on that, but there's a lot of information out there. Obviously, places we're missing there are China, India, And South America isn't mentioned, but in fact, out of one of the North American cases, we did get one from South America. As far as developing countries are concerned, perhaps there's a little way to go yet, but this is a great start, and there's lots of good information in here. So what was the output and what were the conclusions from the project? Well, very briefly summarizing an awful lot of information, on pump systems themselves, we reckon there's between 5 and 15% of improvements to pump systems potentially out there to be gained. On pump technology itself, 3 to 7%, and that's largely because it's a fairly mature technology. Obviously, we've been building pumps for a long time. We should know pretty much what we're talking about, but there are still some gains to be made there. And so there's a little bit of potential left. In drinking water process treatment, we reckon there's up to 20% to be saved there. The but is really that if you look at the next slide we'll look at, we'll show you that there's not actually that much to be gained or that much energy used actually in the drinking water process side. But then moving on to the wastewater side, again, 25% potential gains from wastewater treatment. That is substantial, and there's a lot of energy, and that is increasing in the wastewater process treatment stages. In building services, we reckon you can save up to 15%, and that combined heat and power and renewable energy can make a substantial contribution. But what was interesting from the point of view of this being a global study was that the different regulatory and financial approaches do make an enormous difference to the incentives and how proactive utilities and people are in this regard. So achieving these not only depends on how far you are down the track. In other words, if somebody has been doing this in a very focused and concentrated way for a few years already, then obviously they're on decreasing returns, and they probably won't stand a chance of getting 15% from pump systems. But it also depends on the right policy attitudes and the right financial attitudes. Here's the slide I referred to that says approximately what sort of proportion of the energy is used in the water cycle. This slide actually comes from the UK regulatory body, which is referred to as Ofwat, and it shows basically that about 24% is used in the first stage of clean water or drinking water treatment, that's abstraction and mostly treatment. And about 28% of the total water cycle is used in water distribution. That's pumping to the customers. Moving on to the waste side, about 10% is spent on pumping sewerage. About 32% is spent on wastewater or sewage treatment. And a very large proportion of that is aeration of sewage. So we're talking there about activated sludge plants and their derivatives. And then 6% is of energy is spent on maybe sludge treatment and some disposal. Now, on the clean water side, on the drinking water side, that 24-28 split hides quite a lot of differences, and they are mostly dependent on geography. And that was evident even across the UK. It becomes even more evident when we look a couple of slides down the line. On the wastewater side, that 32% means that if you can get away with perhaps, or if your effluent consents and your treatment facilities allow you to do without aeration and without activated sludge processes, then most of that 32% for aeration energy disappears. So you can make substantial savings by keeping on that side of your consents. So there are big differences in here, but we did find that when you take an industry-wide view, there are a lot of similarities, and these percentages are very close to what is achieved across the USA on an industry-wide basis. The slides from Australia from some very similar coastal cities here show some of the differences. This is not in pie chart form, obviously, but working from the bottom, looking at water supply and pumping from that 0% axis along the bottom there, we have the four major cities in Australia, Sydney, Melbourne, Brisbane, and Adelaide. And the differences in water supply pumping energy consumed there show the story of water resources and how they are managed. Basically, these cities all take their water from a similar different parts of the same mountain range down the east side of Australia. But you see there, Melbourne and Brisbane have very low pumping and treatment costs. And that is because the water comes down out of the mountains, it's under gravity, it's clean, it's sufficient to supply the cities with very little drinking water treatment needed. In fact, that bar at the bottom of the Melbourne column is even less now than it was when this data was furnished, because we know that they've been deriving hydropower energy from their collection system from the source in the mountains down to the city treatment works. So that has got even less. But when you look at the discharge of sewage side, look at that enormous bar on wastewater treatment, which is actually mostly pumping, discharge pumping, at the top of the Melbourne column there. And that is because they sit at the top of a small inland sea about 30 miles across, so they have to pump all their treated effluent about 60 miles around that sea, over a headland, and into a long sea outfall. So their sewage discharge pumping costs are enormous. And so that's the sort of thing that we have to be aware of. So we don't only have to watch out for our water resources, we also have to watch out for our wastewater sinks to keep a balance of the total energy on water. So here's some information on demand management, and this covers some of the case studies from around the world. South Africa, we have a couple there. From the UK, from Australia. And the lessons we've learned from those really are that demand and energy reduction are very closely linked. If you can reduce water demand or sewage infiltration and the sewage flows, then you can obviously reduce the energy. It sounds obvious, but to confirm it, this study showed that there is virtually a linear relationship there, and it's probably the most significant impact you can make on energy demand, is to reduce the actual quantity of water or sewage that you're pumping. And in that connection, the social issues are probably the most prevalent. So public appeals in summer droughts, very positive short-term impacts. People realize what's happening and they cut back on water in the short term. In Australia, they've had 7 years of drought, and that's changed cultures completely. So big shower heads, long showers, all that sort of stuff that used to be part of the Australian culture, because of the drought, because of the water shortages, that has changed around completely. And now Australian culture is very careful indeed with their water. And the lesson that comes out of this really is that technology is often abused and is very rarely the complete situation. We have to get hearts and minds in there too. And one thing that came from me out of the Albuquerque conference last year that I was honored to be present at, was that there are a lot of parallels there with some of the problems faced with U.S. water utilities with the migration of some of the baby boomers from the industrial heartland of the U.S. to the warmer and drier and more water-stressed parts of the U.S. Here's a slide showing a very local to us in the U.K. energy-saving exercise. This is our local one covering my office here in the UK, and it shows that we have energy savings steadily climbing there in spite of, steadily reducing there in spite of a steady climb in water use and in properties connected as we go through that study. So the lessons learned from this part of the study were to protect your resources and sinks, and you have to protect those not only environmentally, but you have to protect them legally and from over-regulation and from over-exploitation, because there are other pressures, notably agricultural, on those water resources as well. If you outgrow those water resources or those waste sinks, they will cost you dear, and that is shown in the Adelaide part of the Australian cities where they are not now taking water from the mountains, they are taking water from the river, and those rivers are decreasing in levels every year. So their pumping and treatment costs are going up every year that drought continues. The independence really refers to Singapore, which has been trying to be independent of Malaysia for its water for a long time. Singapore is a very small but very population-intensive island state, It has a very industrial and highly economic intensive area, and it has historically taken most of its water from the Malaysian mainland, but that's been very risky too. So they've been looking very technologically intensively at water recycling, wastewater recycling, and resourcing all possible links to get clean water back in the front end so that they can be independent. But it has cost them a lot in terms of energy, and it costs them in terms of money as well. We're looking increasingly at leakage, at waste, at infiltration to sewage systems, and supply-demand balance, and they're all very closely linked to energy management. So a holistic approach is the one that will pay dividends in energy management. And that looking across that sort of board, savings of 10% are possible. Now, the last item on this slide really refers to getting things in perspective, and again, we have very similar percentages between the UK and the US. In the UK, the water industry complete takes about 3% of the UK energy demand. So as an industry, we're a small but not insignificant player. And that's a very similar percentage, I believe, to the US. If you look at the amount of energy that is taken across UK water, across UK industry and domestic demand, for just heating that same water, that is about 7 times the energy that the industry spends. So about 20 to 21% of the UK energy demand is actually for heating water. So really that is the big lesson here, that although the industry itself has a sizable demand on the, or sizable proportion of the energy demand for statewide, for heating water, it's at least 7 times as much. So that puts our things in perspective, I hope. Okay, I referred to fact sheets earlier, and on the left-hand side of this slide on pump efficiency, you see a typical fact sheet. This one has a headline, and it's pump efficiency, and what we're looking here is at duty point selection for pumps. So, okay, this is a basic exercise that all pump engineers go through, and this particular slide looks at the emphasis that some clients will put on attaining a particular duty point. They say, yeah, you know, we're comfortable with our pump usually attaining its normal duty point, but it's really important that we hit this top peak duty point way over here on the right of the graph of the characteristic here. And so what we tend to do under those pressures is focus really on providing the best pump that will provide that peak duty. But then we find somewhere at the back of the records that actually that peak duty is only required for perhaps even a few days of every year's operation. And the normal duty would be the one at which the pump will be performing for at least 300 days, perhaps even 360 days of the year. So what we should really be doing is sizing the pump for the normal duty, but making certain that it can still do that peak duty, albeit at a lesser efficiency. And that way we won't lose out for the bulk of the performance of that pump on those energy losses that are shown there. And there are quite a few case studies, as you can see the references at the bottom of the slide there on the left-hand side. And on the right there's a typical one which actually comes from the UK, from a company called Three Valleys Water. And that shows an example of how they rejigged the selection of a set of pumps to make better use of their efficiency. Here's another pump efficiency exercise, this time on duty range. So this one shows how we might use a big pump to satisfy a maximum duty, but at the minimum duty level, we might be losing out on efficiency to quite a large extent, and providing a second pump with a nominally smaller duty would save significantly on the energy of the complete system. The lesson really here is that the cost of providing that extra pump is actually quite small in comparison to the energy costs over the life of the pump. I said earlier that pumping energy was at least 90% of the energy demand in the drinking water sector, and that is really emphasized here. And to cover the range of engineering that's required on the different subjects associated with pumping, we put together 8 fact sheets with the associated case studies in this global report. And so you can see there the sort of savings that we could be making from the various aspects of pumping technology. And you can see there some interesting ones on variable speed drives, on pipework design. There's a specialist one on wastewater pumping, which we won't touch on this presentation, but obviously there are some particular issues with that. And we'll also cover in a minute the intrinsic pump system efficiency exercises. So we weren't short of case studies and examples for this aspect of water treatment. Here's a typical example on pipework, and really this emphasizes a point that I'd like to make through the presentation, that we're not really talking any new technology here. A lot of pumping engineers will be very familiar with the things that I've presented so far and some of the other lessons in this report. So items such as shown on these bullet points here, keeping pumps low relative to suction top water levels, keeping suction velocities low, avoiding short radius bends and sharp corners, avoid swirl in the pump intake, using swept tees instead of sharp edge tees, and perhaps going that extra mile to look at the next size up of pipework to avoid energy costs on pumps. All those things are established technology. But perhaps we've been focused for the last 2 years, as we certainly have in this country in the UK, on reducing capital cost, and perhaps we haven't been looking so much at whole life cost. And with the escalation of energy costs, we could perhaps, with benefit, go back to some of these basics and revisit some of the priorities that these basics give us the opportunity to review. I mean, typically from 2000 to now, energy costs in the UK have gone up something like 3 times. So obviously that sets a slightly different budget perspective on whole life costs to what it did 10 years ago. One aspect of pumping technology that is often seen as the answer to the engineer's prayer are variable speed drives, sometimes known as variable frequency drives, and there may well be other technical terms here. And what this fact sheet does is look at a balanced approach to the variable speed drives, noting that 80% of a pump's whole life cost is the energy it uses. The remaining percentages are fairly small. Maintenance and refurbishment are typically less than 5%. Energy is typically less than 8% of the cost of the whole life cost of a pump. Now, a variable speed drive will often be seen as the answer to a lot of issues, and it does have very significant benefits in a lot of situations. But if you take one of the points, I think it's the fifth one down in that top list of items there, that a variable speed drive will typically take between 4 and 5% of the motor power to drive itself. So before your electrical energy gets to the motor that's driving your pump, 5% of that will be taken off to make the variable speed drive work. So if you're looking for energy savings from variable speed drives, you've got to do better than 5% before you put the variable speed drive in. So what we're saying here is that basically there is no substitute for a correctly designed and sized pump, and if you can get away without a variable speed drive, you will save 5% for a start. There are a number of benefits to using variable speed drives, particularly if you've got a single pump that is doing most of your duty and you can't possibly fit another pump in to match other duties, and yet you still need to meet a variety or a range of pumping duties. Obviously, a variable speed drive will be ideal in that circumstance. And one of the positive points that is often overlooked is power factor correction. Modern variable speed drives will give you close to a unity power factor as seen from the mains power supply, so that'll be good from your energy billing point of view, and you won't be wasting energy on reactive or other power wasting aspects of your power demand, because obviously an electric motor is very much a reactive load. Moving on to the process side of drinking water. So just going quickly through there, we have some resource, water output and energy tariff management issues there. So again, it was a question of measuring and understanding. I think the important thing on this particular study was that so you can't understand anything and you certainly can't do anything about energy efficiency unless you can measure it first. So that was one of the good outcomes there. Sustainability of the energy demand was really reviewing capabilities and understanding historic impacts, looking at optimizing plant, and also looking at renewable resources. And I think this one included a wind energy resource. And the bottom one there shows the advantage of NYSERDA collaboration, looking at pump and valve replacement, energy export, and tariff management. And there was quite a strong feeling that the NYSERDA have done some good collaboration exercises in the New York area. We're looking at pump intrinsic efficiency just to remind ourselves of the basic systems that we're looking at and what we can do to review those situations. Direct online starters are probably most efficient, and then soft start. We've already mentioned variable speed drives. Motors are typically 92 to 95% efficient. You can get high efficiency motors. They're only a couple of percent better than that, so you're on decreasing returns there. Direct drive is best, putting the pump on the motor shaft or with a fairly rigid coupling. But if you must use a belt, coupling or belt alignment is critical. And again, with belts, if you must use something out of line, use timing belts. That's those ones with teeth. Don't use feed belts. They absorb a lot more energy, and they're not as reliable as timing belts. We don't often use gearboxes in pump drives, but there's a note on there. And the one at the bottom there is really basic, and this refers to split casing pumps, where the water is continually going from one side of the pump to the other across a casting parting line. Making sure those castings are properly aligned and fettled correctly is critical to achieving good energy performance. And the one at the bottom, energy internal coatings, can add 5% to pump efficiency, and that's a regular practice now, I think really all across the board. Pump operational efficiency really is looking away from design and construction and installation issues, but looking at how you work the pumps. And we particularly had some good case studies on boreholes and field data. And there were sometimes contradicting reports there that if you've got a series of borehole pumps across a particular aquifer, then use your best pump there and don't worry too much about the rest. Another study showed a very good way of looking at it and saying, well, if you actually use all the pumps together but at reduced throughput, then you don't draw down the aquifer level so much, so you're pumping over less head and therefore you save energy that way. So it's very much a question of horses for courses on how you work your aquifers and boreholes. Check tariffs against your daily routine, so you try and reduce your pumping demand at peak tariff times, so you can save dollars there even if you're not saving kilowatts. Definitely run your best and most efficient pumps and avoid the worst. And on a wider look, more holistic look again, use the cheapest resources. So your cheapest reservoirs and your cheapest way of getting water to the customers. But watch those reserves because you might have to use them in a hurry to satisfy peaks of demand. The issue at the bottom there really refers to, that using pumps is designed, really refers to the size of corporation that you have, and it refers to that corporate structure item at the bottom there. It's interesting from the consultancy viewpoint that we have some clients who are fairly big and therefore they like to come up with standard pumping solutions. And that's not very conducive to getting energy efficient solutions sometimes. And very often we find ourselves working with operators there to try and tailor standard solutions for their purposes. Whereas if you have a smaller company where the engineering aspect can be much more closely integrated with the operational aspect, the chances of getting bespoke pumps to do exactly what is required is much higher, and therefore the chances of getting an energy efficient system are much better. There's a couple of questions really to consider at the bottom of that slide on the basic corporate structure and the objectives involved there. This is on economics. but it is pump economics, so you are still in the right room and on the right conference call. But we're looking here at what I mentioned earlier, which is basically your procurement strategy. You have to make best gains from pump efficiency, select pumps on the least whole life cost, not just on least capital cost. And that's because at least 80% of the pump whole life cost is the energy it uses. Pumps do use between 70 and 90% of water industry energy demand, and certainly on the drinking water side, it's towards the top end of that. And if you are still struggling to justify that slightly more energy efficient pump that you would really like to buy over what your procurement department are telling you you ought to buy, then have a look at future energy prices. And the basis of this is that your pump is going to be probably in that works for at least 20 years. So take perhaps a design half-life of 10 years and look at what the energy costs might be at that time and justify that more efficient pump on those future energy costs halfway through the pump's design life rather than on current energy costs. That should do the trick and get you to a much more energy efficient pump. A note at the bottom really refers to the one on the previous slide, which was about recoating pumps, internal coatings. I had the good fortune to go to Vietnam last year where they were looking at pumps that were of 1950s and 1960s vintage from the USA, some of them, and also some of them from Russia. And there was a company out there that was refurbishing these pumps and recoating them and getting them to a more efficient status than they were when they were first tested at the factory acceptance test before they were delivered back in the 1950s and 60s. And the reason behind that was that they could look at what the current demand was for the duty of that pump, and they could tailor the pump to do that duty more efficiently than had been originally designed. So we can certainly rebuild pumps. We have the technology. It won't cost us $6 million, and we can get there much more effectively than buying new pumps. So there's definitely the road to go for energy efficiency. Here's a typical before and after. This is, I think, Monroe County Water Authority. They have a fairly badly corroded pump there on the left just before it's grip blasted and painted, and the finished article on the right, which should be at least as good as factory acceptance test data and efficiency, if not better. And I'm sure we've all seen pumps in at least that bad a condition before refurbishment. That shows the sort of potential we have. Okay, so that's pumps. Process studies, we had some very interesting comparisons on drinking water process treatment case studies. One from the UK there at the top from Yorkshire Water, where they were looking at dissolved air flotation nozzles, because obviously if you're pumping through dissolved air flotation, there's some quite high pressures involved, so the pumping issues there, energy demand there is quite high. And by replacing their nozzles with more efficient nozzles, they reduced their energy demand there quite significantly. And we also had an issue there with perhaps bypassing dissolved air flotation when possible. That's being actively discouraged now by the UK regulator and the Drinking Water Inspectorate. And we're being encouraged to keep our clarification plant on 24/7, 365, because otherwise there's the potential there for letting the clarification plant go below spec. I mentioned that our European partners were interested in our lack of ability to innovate on process, and we have had a series of energy efficiency case studies there based purely on optimization of process issues. So dosing for coagulation, just refining the issues there and looking at the total effects of dosing and coagulation on the whole of the rest of the clean water and drinking water and sludge treatment cycles there. And basically the knock-on effects from that coagulation refinement exercise went right the way through the whole process, even to the extent of thickening and disposal of the sludges at the far end of the process. We also were looking for potential energy gains on advanced drinking water process plant, and we were asking questions on membrane plant for microfiltration, for ultrafiltration, and reverse osmosis. Now, when you're dealing with these membranes, to get the water through those membranes, you're looking at pressures typically 10 times conventional processes. So perhaps up to, we know this as 50 bar in this country, several atmospheres certainly, which you wouldn't normally look at in conventional processes. Now, our take on that was that since membranes were first installed over in this country maybe 10, 15 years ago, we must have had progress in membrane technology. So there should be lower driving pressures and lower reject rates from your raw water through these membranes. But also, there should be easier cleaning in place systems and lower chemical demands, and much better reliability of the cartridges and fewer failures. So I think there should be a major potential here for looking at package upgrades of old plant that typically your traditional water engineers have fitted and then forgotten about, because the technology is regarded as a package that somebody else comes in and looks after. And it's not typically something that the average water engineer or operations engineer gets involved with. They tend to regard that as a specialist plant that a specialist engineer comes in and looks at from outside. So I'd be very interested to see if there's potential scope there for challenging those package suppliers to come in and say, okay, what actually has your technology done in the last 10, 15 years, and what can it do for my plant that might be in prime target for an energy efficiency upgrade here? In with the somewhat lack of feedback on drinking water process treatment, we've compiled some bar charts here that look at the hierarchy of energy usage. So basically, if you can stick towards the left-hand end of these charts, then you're doing well. If your processes demand something on the right-hand side, then perhaps a quick return to concept to reevaluate how you've got there might be a good idea. But basically, if you're looking at dissolved air flotation, you're going to take a lot more energy than if you're looking at conventional clarifiers. Similarly, we compared sewage treatment processes. If you're looking at conventional biological percolating filters, you use a lot less energy than activated sludge plant or their derivatives, as we said before. Now, as far as sludge treatment is concerned, wastewater sludge treatment, there's a two-way street here. The treatment is a lot more difficult, but the benefits, there's a lot more potential there as well. So again, if you can get away with picket fence thickeners or drum thickeners, your energy use will be a lot less than if you have to use centrifuges. But the benefits there on the drinking water side for sludge treatment are relatively small, and I don't think there's an awful lot of research been done yet on the usage that drinking water sludges can be put to, except to say that if you can reduce the chemical content of them by using more natural processes, then their disposal is an awful lot easier. On the wastewater side, obviously, we're looking at potential gains there from digestion of wastewater sludges, the methane that you can take off of that, and it's been shown that you can run a wastewater treatment process on the methane that you can generate from your digesters by putting that through a combined heat and power plant and using that to generate electrical energy and heat energy to keep the whole process going. Now, it's obviously not relevant to this presentation, but in the wider scheme of things, that is what is happening in wastewater. So as far as the drinking water processes are concerned, sludge handling is easier than wastewater, but I think basically these presets are still applicable. If you let the sludge settle, if it stops, it is sometimes more difficult to get it moving again, and that places stresses on pumps that might not immediately be obvious. But for instance, on things like progressing cavity pumps, starting a sludge after it's been stationary for maybe a weekend is sometimes difficult, and it sometimes wears that pump faster than it should do. The trade-off, obviously, is that if you have to keep that sludge in suspension over a weekend, you might use some mixing energy there. Plant layout is obviously key to keeping sludge pipelines short, particularly if you have a difficult to handle sludge. And obviously the basics of using long radius bends and swept tees are very important there. For sludge mixing, we would contend that the most energy cost-effective method is using zoned air mixing, If you're getting into anaerobic treatment, then obviously you have to use gas mixing, but generally in clean water and drinking water, we would use zoned air mixing there, because with a very small compressor, air compressor, you can keep quite a big tank of sludge in suspension very cost effectively using that technology. We've looked at some corporate fashions apprehensions for mixing sludge using pumps and recycling sludge using pumps, but basically that is a very inefficient system because most of the energy is actually used in moving the sludge around the pipework system, and very little of it is actually used in mixing the sludge. And just a note at the bottom that disposal of the sludge is easier with a reduced chemicals content, but I'm sure anybody who's dealt with disposal of sludge has come up against that problem already. Just to show that the report in its appraisal of wastewater as well as drinking water didn't neglect that side of things. Here's a typical combined heat and power system with a fact sheet on the left there, so the appraisal of the technology is there, complete with combined heat and power and the offtake and the possibility of using the waste heat from the combined heat and power unit and getting the electrical energy out as well. This is not new technology. I don't know the history in the USA, but certainly one major plant in southwest London has been running this technology and effectively ran that complete wastewater plant on sludge energy in 1936. So nothing really new here, but certainly new demands on the works as we put more and more mechanical electrical equipment in the works and make more demands on the effluent quality. What we've listed here are some of the outputs from the global study for building services. So I mentioned that earlier, that we can make energy savings on the existing buildings. And we focused here on buildings that are to do with water treatment, not necessarily offices, but local offices on water treatment sites were taken into account. So we didn't look at domestic or industrial premises here. We looked at proprietary savings issues here, and there's a well-known trade pack that's mentioned there, and we looked at that, and it was actually quite applicable to offices, so there are gains that can be made there. The interesting outcome, certainly from the UK, was that if you have a competent electrical engineer, he can probably equal the savings that can be made there at a much lower cost. And obviously, if you're looking at new offices or if you're looking at refurbishing offices, you can now make major savings on energy there. And typically, the LED schemes are the sort of things to look at in the US. We also looked at the contribution that renewable energy could make, and there are some major savings there from hydro turbines. I mentioned earlier the savings that Melbourne Water are using, and they're logged in there. We've also used some other savings here. We've also looked at biogas and CHP, and a lot of case studies coming in there. So that's some of the renewables issues there. In the US, New Jersey American Water, we're looking at a major solar energy plant there. The interesting issues here are that if you have a works or a treatment plant that has a fairly steady energy demand, then you stand a chance of satisfying that, or at least equaling it, with renewable energy, because renewable energy is typically fairly predictable, but it comes as a steady trickle. It doesn't often come to match your peak energy demands. So if you have a peak pumping demand at a peak time, typically early in the evening, your chances of being able to satisfy that demand using renewable energy are fairly low. Also, American Water, we're looking at wind energy, again in New Jersey. Cleveland Water Department, we're looking at wind energy from their abstraction point out in the lake. And just a note there that we tend to forget gravity, but I remember the Austin Water Utility was looking at better use of gravity from their water intakes, and that energy is certainly renewable. It's powerful stuff, it's gravity, and it's everywhere. We sometimes just need to remember to use it better. An example that we were discouraged from using actually came from a new works in Singapore and the reason we were discouraged was because they thought they hadn't got enough data to confirm its use yet. But basically, we were using a siphon to take water from one part of the plant into another, which was only marginally lower. But because of the different stages of construction, we put in pumps to make the connection, but we didn't actually use the pumps under most operating scenarios. So siphoning is another form of using gravity, and we can use that with significant savings. Looking briefly at the global perspective, the interesting issue I've already mentioned between the Europe and the UK was regulation in the UK versus innovation in Europe, and the way Europeans thought that we were having our regulation stifling innovation in the UK. And that the output of that was really the advanced processes in Europe. We've already covered geography in Australia, and I'm sure across the US, certainly from my experience at the Albuquerque conference, the different geographical challenges in the US were immediately obvious there. So I'm sure there's some resonance with the Australian situation across the US drinking water resources. Self-sufficiency in Singapore, we've covered that. We haven't touched on the social engineering aspects in South Africa. Way back in the original steering group meeting, the South African people said, look, hey, we're going to be learners here. We're going to be the students. We're not going to be contributing to this particular study. And then they came back with two cracking studies on how they'd gone into townships that were relatively poverty-stricken areas of South Africa with a large water demand. And they looked at the water and energy that they were pumping into these township areas, and they said, look, it is worth us doing not only a public relations exercise, but doing a major intervention. And what they did was go into the individual homes and houses and social structures of those townships and do all the water plumbing and piping, right down to new taps, new cisterns, new tanks, new everything. But they took it along with it, a public relations campaign to say, okay, we're doing this, and now it's over to you guys. You look after your resources. And they have saved typically 60% of the energy and water they were pumping into those townships. So major savings by thinking outside the box and doing the public relations campaign with the engineering at a social level. But I think that's a lesson, particularly for the developing world, but it's a great one to come from South Africa. It was interesting that there's opportunities for both teachers and students in the USA. I think this particular quote came from Lauren Fillmore, where she said that some of the more rural works in the US may not have seen some major interventions for some years, and so they may well be some gains there. But in some of the bigger plants that may be linked with universities for PhD studies, then there may be some teachers there. So again, there's lessons to be learned and lessons to be gained, even within the US. And I've mentioned before the need to cover developing country issues. Summarizing the project, I think some of the disappointments we've already mentioned. There's very little feedback on clean water membranes, and I think there's a major opportunity and challenge out there. We were hoping we would get some feedback on mixing comparisons between electrical or powered mixers and flocculators, for example, and hydraulic mixing going through baffles and looking between tanks and looking at those sort of things, and what we call static mixers, where you have essentially static turbines in pipework. We didn't get any direct comparisons with those, which was a little bit of a disappointment. On the wastewater side, we were also looking to get some output between preliminary treatments. So, for example, should you take the grit out before you take the screenings out, or should you take the screenings out before you take the grit out? And we were hoping for some issues on effluent reuse as well. Interesting that we know things are going on there in Australia, certainly in Singapore, and I found out from Albuquerque that, again, things are happening very locally there in New Mexico. Nothing that people felt more perhaps particularly comfortable about yet to tell us about. Successes, we had a great spread of empirical to scientific data, particularly lots on pumping, which we expected and hoped for and got. So there are some major savings there from small investments in pumping and in particularly in wastewater aeration. One major benefit that came from lots of different areas was looking at your consent and looking at how you satisfy that consent with your instrumentation. And very often the instrumentation didn't match the requirements of the consent. And by changing that, there were major energy efficiency gains to be made. But that's on the wastewater side particularly. We confirmed energy usage in a number of different areas, and I think there's some promising studies in renewables coming up there. And I know those are ongoing, particularly in areas like California. Where do we go from here? I think really we have to think outside of our traditional pigeonholes. We have to take the blinkers off and look at holistic catchment management. And across Europe, we have a thing called the Water Framework Directive, which sounds very grand. In fact, what it is focused on is looking at the countries in Europe where one river might flow between four or five different countries. So what tends to happen is that countries at the top of the catchment area are fine and dandy, they're happy, they've not got any problems. When you get down to the bottom of the catchment, those are the countries that have all the problems. And really it's about equalizing the responsibility across those countries and looking at catchment scale issues. And if we look at possible climate change impacts on top of what we know we have there, perhaps more extreme peak rainfall events, that view has been challenged in the UK, so that's interesting, but certainly more runoff because of more hard surfaces. Just putting concrete down to park your car may not seem a big thing on an individual basis, but if you take that across a city like London with 7 to 8 million inhabitants, and I'm sure this is the case in the States as well, more concrete means quicker runoff, and that has major implications for water treatment across the catchment. And some of the mitigation issues there that we might be able to look at. So, for instance, highland peak rainfall management, thereby use of ground land use. So avoid overgrazing on highland so that we get better vegetation, a better capture of rainfall, and therefore less siltation loads down at lowland areas. So some issues perhaps to think about on a holistic scale there. And I think this slide encapsulates that. Basically, we are looking, the UK government, the new government has confirmed the old government's commitments to 80% reductions in energy use by 2050. How do we do it? If we've said that this study, this energy efficiency study, can get us maybe 10, maybe 15%, how do we get the rest of it? And if, in fact, there is only going to be 20% of the energy that we now have available, then how do we use that energy? Looking at that, how much water do we use to generate that energy? Because there's an immense amount of water used in generating energy and including our power stations. And that's all part of the water matrix that we sometimes forget about, along with agricultural demands too. And then if we're going to improve water quality or improve effluent quality, how much more energy will we use? And how much more will that pollute our environment and use more water to cool the plant to produce that energy? And then looking at how much of that energy can we get from renewables. So all this really emphasizes is the interlinking of water and energy. So that concludes the presentation. I hope it's given you a good picture of what the global study came up with and some of the results, and maybe one or two issues there to think about. So we're certainly open for questions now, if we have any time left. My apologies for cutting the time short due to the interruption.
Thank you so much, Roger. That was a great presentation. Lots of good ideas and food for thought for water utilities. One of the questions that I've been receiving is, what is this project number? So if you're interested in locating the final report on the Water Research Foundation website, the project number is 4270, and the website is www.waterrf.org. And then the other question that I've been receiving quite a few of is, can I get a copy of these slides? And yes, these slides, in fact, this WebEx, will be made available on our website early next week. So do check the website then, and you'll be able to download a copy of the slides, a copy of the presentation, and refer any of your colleagues that weren't able to sit in today to that particular vocation. So I want to thank you very much, Roger, for taking time out of your afternoon to provide some information on this topic, and thank you to the audience for listening. Thanks so much. Have a good day now.
Thank you, Leonard. It's been my pleasure.